We are looking at chapter number 7, Federalism. These are certain extra questions. What is federalism? So, federalism is an institutional mechanism to accommodate two sets of politics, one at the national level and then other at the regional level, state level you can say. When and how did federation come into existence? So the federation in India has come into existence by the integration of independently princely states into British provinces. So previously Britishes were there and there were area British ruled. And there are 500 plus princely states also. That is, those have some kings, etc. Now they were also integrated. That is how federation came into existence. Which two countries have faced the disintegration after 1970? So, USSR, Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia and Pakistan. We know Pakistan has become now two parts, Pakistan and Bangladesh. Mention any three federal features of Indian constitution. First is, the constitution is rigid constitution. Most powerful constitution or the most important law in India country. Written constitution is there, that is, we have a proper document, everything is written there, and it gives powers to different institution, different region, different government, that is, division of power is there. How many languages are there in India? So we have 20 major languages. There are so many dialects, but 20 major languages are there. How have the powers been distributed in the Federation of India? So the Constitution of India has provided the various list of powers. First is the Union list, then we have the concurrent list, and then we have state list. So central list, because this number may change, so you just have to confirm. There are right now, while I am speaking, the central list, Union list has 97 subjects, state list have 66, and the common is 47. And in Union list, central government can make laws on these subjects. Similarly, state can make law on these subjects. And concurrent list means state and Union list can make laws on the subject which are enlisted in this concurrent list. What are the factors which make a federalism successful? First is the written constitution. There has to be an independent judiciary and the cooperation and mutual trust between the different governments, that is the central government, state governments, and state governments and state governments, and political parties, of course, and a clear distribution of power in different lists which we have. Mention some unitary features of Constitution of India. So the division of power has gone in the favor of central government, that is, the union government has most of the power, right? Because most of the subjects are enlisted in this central government list or union list. Every individual living in India has single citizenship, that is, he is Indian only. The governor of the state are appointed by the president only, and you know the president is a spokesperson, you can say, of the government which is ruling, that is the prime minister and council of ministers, and they remain in the office till the pleasure of the central government. What is the role of judiciary in federalism of India? So, judiciary is independent. We have an independent judiciary that has been set up to settle dispute between the center and the states and the different states. So, judiciary enjoys the power to resolve the dispute between the central government and the state government, also the state government and state government, if any problem arises on legal matters and division of powers. Now, we have certain short answer type questions. Justify that Constitution of India is a combination of federal and unitary forms of government. So the Constitution of India is unitary also and federal also. So unitary in spirit. How? The distribution of power between the central and state has been made very clear through various lists. Center has more power though. The independent judiciary is there which guard the Constitution to determine either the laws implemented or in the limit of Constitution or not. Whatever the laws are being made by any government, whether it is inside the periphery of the constitution or not. The Constitution of India is rigid on one hand, but it is quite flexible also on the other hand. because there are certain provisions that can be amended. Mention some features of federal government. So federal government is basically a distribution of power between central government and state government to let it work under their own spheres without any interference. So there are two set of polities or politics or government, one at the national level and other at the regional level. And every government is autonomous in their own area or spheres. It combines the national unity along with the autonomy of local bodies. Those local bodies, that is the provincial government, they are autonomous, quite autonomy they have got. Not that much. It works as a custodian to the weaker states to protect them from stronger states. And an independent judiciary is there. Any disputes between center, state or state, there is an independent judiciary. A written constitution, it contains details of power distribution of power and is the supreme in India. Constitution is supreme. Therefore, the federal government establishes unity in diversity, which accommodates all the diversities which we have in a big country like India. Can Union Parliament frame laws on the subjects mentioned in the state list? Explain. Yes, the central government can make, or the union government can make, laws on the state list also. They can make or frame the laws on the subjects mentioned in the state list. There are certain circumstances for that. If any subject has been referred to the central government as the subject of national importance by the Rajya Sabha, the Rajya Sabha is representing states through a resolution passed by 2/3 majority of the members present in voting. There is one article 252. If two or more states desires to frame a law by the central government, and in case if emergency is imposed, any condition can be there, war or some internal external aggression or precedent rule has been declared in the state. Now, the union government can make the laws on the state list. Also, in order to implement some international treaty or convention, this can be done. Explain the financial relationship between the union and the states. There are certain taxes. Right now we have GST, a common tax for whole country. So some certain taxes are levied by the center and collected by the state. That is the stamp duty and taxes on the production of medicine. Taxes are levied and collected by the parliament but are distributed later among the states. That is the terminal taxes, taxes on interest rate, commerce and duties on succession of property other than agriculture land. Now you have to be, you know, very sure that in back of your mind you need to see GST, because everything is GST now. So whatever I'm saying, these taxes are GST now. Certain taxes are levied and collected by the center, but these are distributed between the center and the state, both like income tax. Article 273, it contains the provision regarding the grants provided to the states by the central government out of the consolidated fund of India. This is outside the fund which has been deputed or it is allocated. The states of Assam, West Bengal, Bihar, Odisha, they have been given grants in lieu of export duty on jute and jute products also. A finance commission is appointed by the president of India every 5 years, which makes recommendation on the financial matters to be referred by the president, and they will say what amount can be given, what amount can be withheld, like this. Now we have certain passage based questions. Broadly, two types of disputes keep recurring. One is the border dispute. States have certain claims over the territories belonging to the neighboring states. Though language is the basis of defining boundaries of the state, often border areas would have population speaking more than one language. So it is not easy to resolve this dispute merely on the basis of linguistic majority. One of the long-standing border disputes is between Maharashtra and Karnataka over the city of Belgaum. Manipur and Nagaland also have long-standing border dispute. The carving out of Haryana from the previous or erstwhile state of Punjab has led to dispute between the two states, not only over border areas but also the capital city, Chandigarh. Chandigarh is capital of both Haryana and Punjab. Now this city today houses the capital of both these states. In 1985, then Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi reached an understanding with the leadership of the Punjab, and they said, okay, Chandigarh will be given to you. That is, according to the understanding, Chandigarh was to be handed over to Punjab, but this has not happened till date. So mention any two type of disputes between the state. So there is one dispute is the boundary. This is the boundary. They say, we have this boundary. They said, this is my boundary. Sharing of river. Say we have Karnataka, then Tamil Nadu. Now this Kaveri river, this passed through first Karnataka, then goes to Tamil Nadu. Now Karnataka has done a lot of work like making dams, etc. So the water is not reaching out to Tamil Nadu, and Tamil Nadu is hotter because the latitude, if you see the latitude it lies, it's hotter than the Karnataka region. Then on which city Maharashtra and Karnataka have dispute? Belgaum district, Belgaum city. Name the leader who reached an agreement understanding with Punjab and when? This was in 1985, then Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi. What was the agreement? That Chandigarh, which is actually now the capital of both Punjab and Haryana, will be handed over to Punjab. Now, most of the Muslim majority state joined Pakistan, but Jammu and Kashmir was an exception. Under these circumstances, it was given much greater autonomy by the constitution. According to Article 370, the concurrence of the state is required for making any laws in matters mentioned in the union and the concurrent list. This is different from the position of the other state. In the case of other state, the division of power are listed through the three lists automatically applies. In the case of Jammu Kashmir, the central government has only limited power and other power listed in the union list and the concurrent list that can be used only with the consent of the state government. This gives the state of Jammu Kashmir greater autonomy. Now let me tell you before answering this, this Article 370, which was the for the autonomy of various things are written here, this has been abrogated. Now Jammu Kashmir is not a state. It has become J&K Union Territory and Ladakh Union Territory. So these questions I am answering, but this question doesn't have any meaning now. Under which article of constitution Jammu and Kashmir has been considered exceptional? This is Article 370 abrogated. What is the exception? The state of Jammu Kashmir enjoys the greater autonomy than other state, as the northeastern state also enjoy autonomy under Article 371. How does J&K exercise this autonomy? In the case of Jammu Kashmir, the central government has only limited power and other listed in union list and concurrent list can be used only if the said state government is consenting. Now we have certain long type questions. Legislative powers have been distributed between the central and state government. Justify. So the legislative relation between the central government and the state government has been distributed through various lists. We have union list, state list and concurrent list. So union list, this list have certain subjects, and since it is changing, so you will see the number being changed after 42nd amendment, and previously it had 97. On these subjects, only central government can frame or implement the laws, and these subjects are of national importance and equally applicable to all the citizens of the India. The examples are defense, foreign affairs, railways, peace and war, and communication. Now the state list, the list contains 66 subjects after 42nd amendment, because previously it was 62. On these subjects, only states can legislate the law, and these subjects are of state importance. The examples are police, education, public health, law and order, and local self-government. Then we have the concurrent list. This list consists of 52 subjects. After 42nd amendment, it was previously 47. Both the central and state government can implement laws on these subjects. And this includes marriage, divorce, electricity and price control. Then we have some apshisht powers, that is called residuary powers. And to make the center strong, the residuary power has been given to the central government only. Now, union government can implement laws on the state of these subjects of state list. This is also possible at the resolution of Rajya Sabha by 2/3 majority, which has declared any subject of national importance. Now, the union government can make laws on this. If two or more states request the union government to enact law on a particular subject, union government can make a law on state subject. If emergency has been proclaimed, either on the basis of failure of constitutional machinery or some external war or internal aggression or armed revolt, union government can make laws on state list. What is the administrative relationship between the center and the state government in India? So the center government is empowered to give direction to the state government. If it feels that any law has become some hindrance in the functioning of central government, or any law has been executed very well, has not been executed very well, so central government can always direct the state government. The governors of the state are appointed by the central government only. They are representative of the central government only, who works as an agent between center and state. So the governor informs about the functioning of the state to the central government, and the council of ministers reserve the right to remove him also. The governor, if he is not doing by the will of the government, which is in the majority in the center, he can be removed or she can be removed. The parliament establishes an interstate council also to inquire into the interstate disputes, to submit recommendation and to consider the common interest. If emergency situation is there, apatkal, if it is proclaimed due to external or internal aggression or war or failure of constitutional machinery, all the powers are vested now in the hands of central government. Now the central government become a unitary government now to implement the laws on the subject mentioned in the state list. Now we have certain picture based questions. So this is a picture during discussion on the national language in the Constitutional Assembly. Nehru had to appeal to the Hindi speaking provinces to show greater tolerance towards others. Identify the person who is making an appeal. He is Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, our first Prime Minister. What appeal is made by him? He is saying that, you know, people wanted, because 30 to 40% people speak Hindi. So everyone wanted, most of the, you know, the belt is, which comes to large states are there in the central part, which are speaking Hindi. So they, most of the people are saying that let's have Hindi as the national language. So to show greater tolerance towards the other language, because they are great states like Tamil Nadu, they are states like Karnataka, they don't speak, their native language is not Hindi. So they need to show tolerance towards these states. Then what message does the cartoon convey? The autonomy demands may be related to cultural and linguistic issues, because some states feel that there is a domination of Hindi speaking areas over others. Other states also, because they are also a part of this country, they also want representation of their language. Now this is the cartoon, floods of demands for creating new states. What message does the cartoon convey? Now everyone is demanding, because you know, in a state, there can be two political parties, party 1, party 2. Now this party is in power, what will happen to this party? This party will ask for two states, because they also want power. So demand for new states. How did it happen? During the national movement, it was decided that as far as possible, states would be created on the basis of common culture and linguistic identity. And people of various state thinks that this is not happening. When was the state's reorganization commission set up? It was in December 1953. You can see here. There is a year given. So this is all about the question and answer of this topic. Thank you so much. Take care of yourself.